this month's campus sport, Poland's champion hammer thrower and the nation's top sports academy. We meet the world's best with a bow and the javelin thrower fighting against the odds. Plus, basketball 3-on-3 and the remarkable world of Britta Heidemann, all coming up on Campus Sport.
My name is Paweł Fajdyk, and I'd like to invite you to watch the Campus Sport program. Welcome to my home. I'd like to show you my medals and titles, so please come in. Paweł Fajdyk is a student athlete who's excelled in the hammer throw, not only at the Universiads, the World University Games, where he's won 3 titles in a row, but he was also successful at the last 2 World Championships. A student of sports education for the past 6 years, Fajdyk is in fact the reigning champion in the hammer throw, and his medal collection is truly impressive.
Now,
I'd like to show you my medals and my trophies that I've won this year. Here's a medal that I won at the last Universiad in Gwangju.
Drugi medal, który jest obok, and this, jest z aktualnych
the third
świata,
gold medal I won at the Universiad. The next one is from the World Championships in Beijing. And here you can see the most important trophies that I've won over the past few years.
Tutaj znajdują się też najważniejsze trofea, które
in the center here is the medal from the World Championships in Moscow.
Na samym środku widzimy medal z Moskwy.
And then on either side of that, on the two sides, well, you can see 2 more medals that I won at the Universiad. This is my first diploma. I tried to collect everything, but now I'd love to have a room dedicated to his trophies and medals. Okay, now we're going to the place where I started training. It's a little bit dilapidated, but hopefully there's still a concrete slab there, so follow me. When he was a kid, Paweł used to play soccer in the same stadium and came naturally to the hammer throw. This is the first circle where I learned how to throw. He started the sport when he was 15 years of age and immediately became Polish champion. But another competition has had great significance in his career. The fact is, the Universiad is a very important competition, because that is where I started my sports career. The first Universiad I took part in was in 2011 in Shenzhen. I went there as the European Under-23 champion. I remember I treated it like any other challenge, but really, you know, it was a big step in my preparations before the World Championships coming up in Daegu.
Elementem przygotowawczym do Mistrzostw Świata w Daegu.
Fajdyk became the Universiad champion in Shenzhen with a throw of 78.14 meters. He finished only 11th in the Daegu Worlds, but he was on the right path. And 2 years later, in 2013, he won the double. Then a few weeks ago in Gwangju, with a throw of 80.05 meters, his final throw, Paweł took his 3rd victory in a row at the World University Games, a record in the men's hammer. It would be the springboard for his performance in Beijing just a few weeks later, when he retained his world title. The Universiad has become very important for me. I always want to perform well in this competition. So I traveled out to Gwangju and succeeded well. And let's hope that in 2 years' time, well, I'll have the opportunity to fight for the Universiad record. The record stands at 82.77 meters. And all these competitions have taken place while pursuing his academic goals. The physiotherapy student of the University of Warsaw has managed to combine a dual career. I'd like to take this opportunity to say a word for those students watching this program. I'd like to encourage you to practice sport. And I'd like to say that starting with the Universiad really is significant. You know, these competitions, they're just like little Olympic games, really.
Bardzo przydatny i tak naprawdę są to małe igrzyska. Okej, więc ja już swoje rzeczy spakowałem.
I've already packed my things now and I've got to go, I'm afraid. Hope you've learned something more about me, how I am, how I train, about my beginnings in sport and about my life. You've also got to know my plans for the future, so now time to say goodbye. And the next major goals for Fidek, the Rio Olympics and the 27 Universiad in Taipei. We're heading for Katowice, a city in the center of Poland's Silesian region, to discover one of the country's six sports academies. But the Jerzy Kokusia Academy is the only one dedicated to competition sports, welcoming many big names like Justyna Kowalczyk, Kamil Stock and Adam Małysz. The Academy of Sport has existed for 45 years. It was founded in 1970. The first name was the School of Physical Education. Then there was just one department of physical education, but since then there's been a big development, and today there's a total of three departments and nine buildings. Today, 5,000 students are at the academy working in 20 disciplines. 400 of them are high-level sports students. A special individual program is available for current or future champions who need a specific schedule and training for their dual career. We're in the temple of muscular power and strength. So let's meet Professor Michał Wilk, many times a press bench medalist and world champion.
Witaj, Michał.
Professor Wilk is working on the individual program, as they call it, by analyzing the different skills of champions. Among others, he's coaching the ski jumping Olympic champion Kamil Stock and the retired ski jumping star Adam Małysz. Adam Małysz's training is about car racing now. He's training for the Dakar Rally, and he needs to strengthen his upper body, because as a ski jumper, he worked only on the lower part of his body, and the top part really was forgotten. Now let's go into the hypoxia room, where we're going to meet Professor Miloš Šuba. Come with me, close the door. Because conditions inside here are like those at high altitude.
Warunki są wysokogórskie już, także żeby nie stracić. Cześć Miłosz, witam.
Students usually come once a week to test their endurance and cardiac stress at high altitude. It's all linked with their individual program. Now we're in the laboratory of molecular and genetic biology. It's unique in Poland. I hope we won't disturb the professor. Professor Andrzej Malecki tries to find within a person's genes the physical and mental qualities that make a champion. His results help to improve the performances of the student athletes in Katowice. On offer to the students academically are management, physical education, physiotherapy, and tourism and recreation. In between classes, the students can use all the modern infrastructure for the necessary training. A precious aid for athletes like the gymnast Wojciech Dakiewicz. I have classes 5 times a week from Monday to Friday, starting at 7 a.m. and finishing at 2 or 3 p.m. And then I can train from 5 to 7 in the evening. I train during the weekends as well, but the schedule then is loose and there are many time changes. Jakub Kubeniec is a judoka, the Polish champion in the under 80 kilogram class. He's another example of the dual career at the Katowice Academy. Judo training takes place twice a day, 10 sessions a week, and Sunday is free, so I can study. That's why I'm at this academy. I enrolled for the individual program so that I can combine sport and study and get specific high-level training.
co mi umożliwia.
What I do is I fix my schedule with my teachers and decide with them the dates and the times for the classes and the exams.
Jakieś zajęcia na zaliczenie.
The Katowice Academy, supporting and promoting Polish university sports and spirit at a high level. Coming up, the world's best with a bow and the javelin thrower fighting against the odds. Plus, basketball 3-on-3 and the remarkable world of Britta Heidemann in just a moment.
When education meets sport and culture,
on your mark,
what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Gwangju, city of the 2015 Universiade, the city of the great archer as well, the world number one, Ki Bo Bay. The 2015 University Games were held in Gwangju, and because they were organized here in South Korea, we had a lot more pressure compared with our opponents. But I'm really happy about what I've accomplished and what I've done for my country. Two gold medals and one silver. Ki Bo Bay, double Olympic champion, five times the world champion, and with five gold medals at the Universiades. I knew the spotlight was on me since the Olympic Games, so I had a lot of pressure. But I also recognized it was my job to go to the shooting range, producing the best possible performance to achieve the best possible results. Ki Bo Bay had proved to be a fantastic competitor, but she'd never beaten the world record until the Gwangju Universiade in the individual and team event. After the competition, all the journalists asked me about how I felt after beating the world record. Ah, I said, I beat the world record. I couldn't believe it myself. Usually when I saw athletes break world records or impose new marks, I always told myself that I would do the same. And after the Universiade, when I managed to beat the world record, I told myself that I had finally been successful. I felt a form of accomplishment, and I knew that all that hard work I'd done had paid off. Archery is a Korean speciality. The nation has enjoyed international success for decades. Archery is a sport that appeals to all your senses. There's deep introspection in it. You have to train yourself every day, and some days I train for about 10 hours. But on average during the week, I train between 4.5 and 5 hours per day. Because I'm doing advanced studies, it's sometimes tough, especially when I spend 10 hours a day in my training, because at the same time, I must not miss my exams. Often, I have to add 3 hours a day of additional study to prepare for my exams, so I can't do anything else. The Korean team won 8 of the 10 competitions held in Gwangju, confirming once again in the University Games the global domination of the Koreans in this discipline. We don't have any special training that makes us better than the others. It's mainly because we have a lot of former champions in the disciplines who've had excellent results internationally. And for generations that follow, they give us many reference points. Those former champions are role models, and they drive us to do as well as them.
I think throughout my career in archery, the Gwangju Universiade will remain one of my greatest moments.
Ki Bo Bae, a true star of the 2015 Universiade.
Just being here in the Athletes Village is unbelievable. It's a huge place, and it's really neat. It's So every track meet, they go to, I take this from my mom. It's something she gave to me, and I usually put it in my shorts when I compete, so it's right with me.
In Gwangju, Andy White realized his dream of wearing the Canadian jersey. It was a childhood dream. He'd held it since the moment he made a promise to his mother.
It's such an honor to wear my Canadian jersey, mainly because of my mom. So when she was 17, she made her first national team, and she ran for Canada at the Pan American Cup. So my mom, she passed away in January 2010. She had breast cancer. So for me to have this achievement of making a Canadian team, something that she had done, and it was such a special accomplishment for her, it really made it a special one for me to follow in her footsteps. And for me, my mom always said, follow your dreams.
Andy is a student of fine arts in Vancouver and a sporting hero of the university. But the qualification process for the World University Games was fraught, to say the least. After a lot of frustration, Andy had just 48 hours to qualify for Gwangju, and the qualifying meeting in Lethbridge was a long way away.
I put a bed in the back of my dad's truck, and I hopped in it, and I drove 1,200 kilometers across the country to Lethbridge, Alberta. And I went there to compete, and when I got there, it was not a good day to compete. It was pouring rain, so windy, umbrellas were turning inside out from spectators on the sidelines, and I just couldn't get off a good throw. I said, well, the deadline for FISU is tomorrow.
Andy would attempt one last shot at qualifying for Gwangju, the last possible meeting in Kamloops.
I took all my wet clothes and I hung them around my truck, and I headed straight to Kamloops. And that was just over 800 kilometers I had to drive that night. So I literally drove straight there. I only stopped for some gas, and when I arrived, it was midnight. As I was sleeping in the early hours of the morning, I heard boom, and something hit my car. And I woke up right away, looked around, and there's a guy walking around my truck, and he was hitting the windows.
It was unnerving for him. Andy called the police just to make sure he'd be safe and ready to compete in a few hours' time.
So I had about five and a half hours sleep at most. And, I woke up just shaking in fear and adrenaline. So I went to the competition site, and I started my warm-up, and I was actually feeling surprisingly pretty good. And I thought, you know what, if you just stay focused and keep on this track, you're going to do this. And when it came time to it for my very first throw, I threw the standard 71.14 meters, and just 14 centimeters over the qualifying mark of 71 meters.
In Gwangju, Andy once again found the common feature of all his adventures, bad weather. He was cursed by rain right up until the warm-up of the competition. Not the best preparation for the javelin event. The 25-year-old Canadian was about to face his first international competition as well.
When I got in, it was really neat. I mean, we got to walk into the call center, we sat down. You could see the stadium through the other end of the building, and when we got to walk into the stadium finally and it opened up to see the crowd, it's like, wow, it's a beautiful, huge stadium, and people are cheering there. So pretty surreal feeling.
After all that, Andy didn't make the podium. But was it so important? He'd taken part in the Universiade, he'd worn the Canadian jersey,
he'd kept his promise to his mother. More than a sports event, the Gwangju Universiad was for him something of a journey of initiation.
It's very clear for me that the lesson is you can go through many different defeats, many different setbacks, and as long as you stay committed to that, you can accomplish what you've set out to accomplish.
Andy White of Canada at the World University Games, Gwangju 2015. Still to come on campus sport, basketball 3-on-3. And the remarkable world of the champion fencer, Britta Heidemann.
When education meets sport and culture, what best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
Welcome back to Campus Sport and a quick word on the 3x3 Basketball World League Final in Xiamen in China. China's Tianjin University of Finance and Economy took the women's gold. They defeated the Cultural University of Taipei 21-13. Wu Di was judged the most valuable player after her 16 points in the final. In the men's final, the University of Montreal faced the University of Bordeaux. It was a tense match, the French team scoring in the last minute to level the game at 16 points apiece. The clock ran on into the final 30 seconds of the game when the Canadians got their 17th point and hung on for the victory, winners of the World League title. Speaking fluent Chinese and excelling in fencing may be two completely unrelated abilities. But for Britta Heidemann, both play a role in finding a perfect balance in her life. It's a philosophy she's held since the year 2000, when she switched from the modern pentathlon into full-time épée fencing. I believe for me, it was always quite important that I worked ahead and planned step by step. The key to success is certainly discipline and hard work. But I guess it's also the joy of going further and in the end paving the way to success. I believe from fencing, you really can learn a lot. The mental strength, the handling of the pressure, and the concentration I have to have when preparing for a duel. And how can you enjoy all that? Well, I find all those elements in fencing are really so fascinating. I wish everybody approached it like I do. It would mean simply standing in the fencing hall and being happy with that, like me. Happy to collect her first experience as well in a multi-sport event like the Universiade in Beijing in 2001. The Chinese capital would play an important role in Britta's life. At the time, the German épée fencer wasn't in the top 10, but it was there she started a new chapter in her sporting life. For me, the Universiade of 2001 really was the starting point where I realized that this big multi-sport event meant a lot to me. The Universiade is organized like the Olympic Games. There's also an athletes' village, a meeting point for everybody. And I immediately felt at home there. And I said to myself, this is something I want to experience again. That was the moment where I started actively to feel I could take part in the Olympic Games. The world champion in épée fencing in 2007, 1 year later, she won Olympic gold in her second hometown of Beijing. By now, she'd been there many times. She'd learned the language and the culture. And Britta received so much support and congratulation from the huge number of local fans, she simply became a star name. I think many Western Europeans see the Chinese as different from what they really are. I never had any prejudices towards them. I was completely unabashed when I left for that country. And I was also very young when I went there. In fact, Britta discovered China with her family at the age of 13. And shortly afterwards, she lived there for 2 years with a Beijing family, where she was named Zhao Yue, Little Moon. She studied Chinese literature, law, political structure, and economy. Chinese is not an easy language, and the sinology studies were tough. I spent a lot of energy in those studies.
Das hat mich teilweise sehr viel Energie gekostet.
I studied in the plane, during my trips and competitions, and sometimes I even used it as mental training. So I fought through these studies, and now I'm totally happy. Now I can just get on with my life, and I can do a lot with my academic background. In 2009, Britta Heidemann graduated in Chinese Regional Studies at Cologne University. Her thesis was on China's wind industry. Britta is concerned about major challenges caused by large-scale development in China, challenges like pollution. In China, it's a topical subject because of the development of a population of 1.4 billion. They experienced a jump in their progress, something like we ourselves have experienced in small Europe, in small Western Europe, and not easily mastered. I don't believe that in our industrialization phase the sky was always blue. The Chinese are tackling this problem massively in their own country. Today, Britta is an important figure in two continents. With her work for Germany and China as a consultant, she has a voice in politics, economics, sports, and culture. A bridge between two worlds, two cultures. I'm in the German-Chinese Dialogue Forum, attached to the German Foreign Ministry, a so-called accompanying organ. I was a European Union Ambassadress of Youth. Also, simply by my traveling, I take part in conferences, I'm involved in many things, and I try to contribute to a better understanding between the cultures. China's got to be present more and more on the world scene.
Zwischen den Kulturen zu vermitteln, China wird einfach immer präsenter.
The silver medalist at last year's World Championship is currently trying to qualify for the upcoming Olympic Games in Rio. At this year's World Championships in Moscow, her results were disappointing. She finished 19th, but she had big problems then with her Achilles tendon. I really, really want to be able to take part in the Rio Olympics. I keep telling myself that I've already celebrated a lot of incredible success, and this will certainly be my last Olympic Games. I'll give it everything, but my world will not explode if I fail. I'll still have a life after sport. Britta Heidemann has managed a brilliant dual career. She's not only an example for young fencers to follow, but for all student athletes. And the German epee fencer has a special message to deliver.
If you can give everything, you can reach even more than you ever thought.
And don't forget to enjoy it. When you give it your best, if you also have a smile on your lips, then I want to wish you the best success. And that was Campus Sport. Until next time.
Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
The International University Sports Federation brings together millions of students worldwide around the same values, excellence in mind and body. Thousands of students, hundreds of universities participate in FISU events, the rendezvous for the best student athletes. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.